Welcome to PartialArc.com. Don't do that.
You find yourself in a tavern.
Yo, we should have checked for traps.
I knew we forgot something.
I think I can reason with him.
You killed his father.
Can I have sex with it?
You could certainly try.
I'm gonna touch a sword.
Don't touch the sword!
The child is evil, right?
Obviously.
I could cast Fireball.
Always cast Fireball.
All right. Roll for it. Welcome to Friday Night Quests. I'm your host and Dungeon Master, Jay Jones. This week we kick off our 13th season of the Velvet League's adventures, and we're joined by special guest, Taylor Glockner. Taylor is best known in the States for the Australian shows Mako Mermaids and Strange Calls, and he was a ton of fun to play Dungeons & Dragons with. So without further ado, let's get to the game. All right, let's meet our players. First up, we have Jeremy Fox. Jeremy is a writer for film and television, and Jeremy is playing the human fighter, Prince Horace Kemp. Jeremy, we never really show any scenes of our characters eating or drinking.
Uh-huh.
I mean, we do show some scenes of our characters drinking. But we actually never talk about what the characters of the show actually like to eat. What's Prince Horace Kemp's like favorite food?
Oh, cucumber sandwiches.
Cucumber
sure.
sandwiches?
For sure.
Is that
With
what
the crust cut off.
Is that what Gormo's always bringing you
yeah,
on trays?
Yeah, that's when I say get a sandwich. It's a cucumber sandwich with a little bit of sour cream.
Wow. That's nice.
Oh, no, cream cheese.
Oh, cream cheese?
Not sour cream.
I actually feel like that's an answer you've given on the show before. Like, that's actually continuity accurate.
Oh, good.
I think you've referenced cucumber sandwiches, too, a couple times.
I think yeah. we actually have.
I think that there's a conspiracy.
Well, you guys don't remember when you slayed the cucumber god and you made sandwiches
and he said,
out of
no,
him?
No, you own all the sandwiches. No.
That was our Vin Diesel season. It's a real shame that we can't use that.
It was like, your one curse, you must eat cucumber sandwiches forever. And you're like, great.
Best.
No, Prince Horace honestly is genteel. Even though he's covered in blood by the end of every episode, he is genteel. He likes tea time. He likes, you know, a gentle conversation. And
nice.
Rosé.
And rosé.
Yes.
Rosé's food.
Yeah. It's a kind of food.
It counts.
Rosé's
that explains so much about our behavior.
It covers most of the food groups. Next up is Kelly Egan. Kelly is a digital strategist, and she plays the half-elf druid Ysabel Izzy Buchanan.
Hello.
Kelly, same question.
Yeah.
What is Izzy's favorite food?
Izzy's favorite food is what I would call an earth bowl.
Ooh.
It's some sort of starch, usually like brown rice, and then there's some sort of like fermented sea greens on top of it, and then a little bit of like a pickled either, you know, cucumbers or pickled cabbage. It's kind of like a what actually I just ate before we started this.
It's a
Korean bibimbap bowl.
She who smelled it.
So there's like
it.
Tofu in there, mushrooms in there, sea greens,
oh, nice.
A vinegar thing, and then some sort of sauce over it. So
you have
like
the
earth bowl.
Izzy has like the best diet of, although mm-hmm. you're eating cucumber sandwiches so far, like very, very healthy,
yeah,
meticulous food choices.
Yeah, not like a rack of lamb or anything.
I only eat the finest raccoon leg. Kelly, that
yes.
sounds delicious. Our next player is Mike Christensen. Mike is my partner in crime on the Because Comics podcast, but with us, he plays the half-elf wizard, Sweeney. Mike, same question. Sweeney's favorite food.
Sweeney's a bit of a dumpster diver.
Not surprising.
So it's kind of just what he can get his hands on. Mm. Something with some protein helps get him through the day. And by dumpster dive, I do mean taking food off of other people's plates as he cons them.
Oh, you stay
That
fries.
Is not the definition of dumpster.
It does mm. not, no.
Well,
how many dumpsters are you counting
like
out there in like the Feywild?
You're like a seagull. Just,
yeah, that's exactly.
Yeah, you're like a seagull.
Yeah. He's a scavenger of sorts.
Okay.
The Five Kingdoms are very like, they're very aware of like nature. So
yeah.
they leave dumpsters throughout like
oh,
the long
really
paths
nice.
Throughout the kingdom. And
yeah.
you're just always dumpster diving.
Only you
there.
Can prevent forest fires all over the
Little signs like that. We always skip by it, but they're just everywhere.
Recycle. Other people can eat this.
Yeah. In, like he's dragon a, caverns mm-hmm. and like volcanoes.
There's a lot of freegans in the Five Kingdoms.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. All right, and finally, our guest today is an actor best known for the Australian shows Conspiracy 365 and Neighbors. And in the U.S., he's known for Mako Mermaids and The Strange Calls. Taylor Glockner is with us today.
Hey,
welcome,
guys.
Taylor.
Thank you for having me. Thanks, everyone.
Taylor, tell us a little bit about your character.
I really think he's a bit of a traveler. You know what I mean? He goes from town to town, city to city. I would think his favorite food would probably be like a pub meal or something like that.
Nice.
Something with some meat, like.
Like a pot pie.
Like
a
shepherd's you know what I mean? Like some mashed potatoes, like maybe a beer. He works by the fire. His name is Elon Santiago Glockner. And I went with my last name. This is my first. I was researching Elon Musk. I love Elon Musk. So I was like, all right, that's going to be the first name.
I love it.
Santiago from The Alchemist. Because the kid's name is Santiago. He travels from town to town.
Nice.
And then I was like, what can I come up with? What's a great last name? I was like, oh, use my own last name.
So he's like family.
Well, it's my first game. So I thought I'd just play it pretty simple, try to stick to the basics. And hopefully you guys help me out today. Cause my
let's pretend that's like your great-great-grandpa.
Yeah.
In the real world.
Yeah.
Like my
aunt. This Elon past, Santiago. Right? Yeah, yeah.
This style takes place in the past.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, we're going to hit the American Revolution very soon.
That'd be awesome.
That's awesome. Wow.
So I'd say his favorite food would probably be like a pub meal or something like that, because he doesn't get to eat a good meal very often because he's always traveling. That's what I'd say.
That sounds nummy.
That does. All right, guys.
We should say what his class and race and stuff are.
Oh, yeah. What is your class and your race?
I am a cleric of war.
Ooh. Oh,
so I have spells and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Wow. And my race is this one here. Mm-hmm. Human. Okay. Nice. I thought I played basic.
Damn, that's exotic.
Mike came to me with all these different ideas of like different races I could do, and I was like, all right, look, first game, I'm just going to play human. Just keep it chill.
That's you could be a smart. Broom.
My race is broom.
Oh, okay.
All right, guys. So we now dive in and begin our game. So since we last left the Velvet League, you guys had met Izzy's mother and had found out that Izzy's father, Ron, had been taken into the Underdark and had been reclaimed by Ron's grandfather, Izzy's great-grandfather, who you guys don't know much about. So it's been several weeks. You guys have traveled different towns, and you've come upon Elon, and Elon has actually found and ferried you guys through and into the Underdark to find the city and the information to find Ron. So several weeks have gone by, and you guys have been on some crazy, harrowing adventures together. You guys have run into aboliths and weird things in the Underdark.
Oh,
and
we've been in the Underdark for weeks.
You guys have been in the Underdark for weeks.
Holy moly.
Navigating through tunnels and things, and you're getting very close to the city that you're looking for. Through the information and channels you have found, you find that Ron is being held, and this is the city of his grandfather and your family, Izzy, where they came from, the city of Felsiri. It is the city of the Shadowed Web, nestled deep in the Underdark. And you know there is a popular juncture point, a point of trade for people of different civilizations of Drow and also different denizens of the Underdark that is very close to Felsiri. And you guys are coming upon this juncture, this crossroads, essentially, where people trade and different things, and that is where you are arriving now. You are coming through a cave at this point, dark stalactites and stalagmites above and below, and just below
which
you...
Which is which?
Oh my
God. Stalagmites are... Fuck.
No, it's tight to the ceiling.
Oh, that's right. That's right, good.
Test. A+, you got an A+.
Thank you. So stalactites... hanging above you, definitely above you, stalagmites shooting up in front of you.
Shooting up.
Roll for initiative. No. And each of these stalagmites are pretty large. Each is about the size of a column, so you guys can kind of move through them much like a maze, but you can clearly start to see purplish and orange light down ahead, and you hear the bustlings of travel in cities.
What's our light source? What are we carrying?
That's my question for you. Oh. What have you guys been utilizing to get through the Underdark? Now, the Underdark, if anyone doesn't know, is... I mean, its name kind of tells it. It is typically...
Super bright and
under
nice.
It is under the earth. It is a dark realm where typically darker creatures reside. Mm-hmm. It is not a friendly place. There's a lot of monsters and things that lives in caverns and caves, but a popular society that populates the Underdark is known as the Drow, which Izzy is a half-Drow.
Mm-hmm.
So
dark elves
basically. Yeah, they have pitch black skin and white hair, and they tend to be more, you know, well, you might find out what they're like.
Well, I mean, I don't have to find out what they're like. I hang out with one.
That's true.
Hey,
your knowledge is every single Drow is exactly like Izzy.
Yep, you're gonna fit in just fine.
Okay, so light source. You have light, right?
No.
Sweeney?
No. I do. I've never had the light source.
I just made me thinking about your soul.
Oh, thank you.
What about Elon? What kind of light you got?
I'm doing a little bit of the Star-Lord, the Chris Pratt Star-Lord thing, and I'm using my... I've got goggles of night.
Oh, so you're not helping us.
Casting light for anyone else.
I was like, you guys got this.
Horace, I'll remind you, you're the only one of us with his goggles of night. You're the only one without dark vision.
Oh. That's right, because Horace is a human as well as Elon, but Elon's got those goggles, so he's fine. You're like bumping into
Columns. Well, here's the thing is I've always let Gormo hold torches.
We haven't seen Gormo in years.
Yeah, we haven't seen Gormo in a long time.
I can make you a torch. Yeah. After all this time down
but
here.
But I don't want to hold it. That's the problem.
Well, I'm not casting daylight. That's going to use up my spell slot.
I got an adorable image like Gormo like holding you by the hand through like dark caverns.
He's just always held my torch. Here's the thing. When you're a warrior, you hold your sword.
Yeah.
And you hold your shield.
Oh, that's true.
That's how you look princely. That's how you look strong.
That's true.
A man holding a torch and a sword, that is pedestrian.
That is good. Especially
so
for a noble.
So I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to have bruised knees. And bruised legs. And I'm just
bumping into things.
Yeah, for the last 2 weeks, I have been stumbling through the Underdark.
Oh my God.
Trying to hold on to. Elon, are you wearing a cape?
Yes, sir, I am.
Then I've been holding on to your cape.
Okay. That's cool.
I tried not to let you know.
What order are we walking along?
I'm probably right now. Well, so I'm supposed to be leading. Fuck.
Are you supposed to be leading?
I mean,
Elon's leading.
I'll lead because
all right, then I'm right
showing.
Elon.
Yeah,
I know what.
I'm right behind.
I'm showing you through this, right? And then you're behind me, holding my cape.
Yeah,
and I guess I'm in front. I don't know how I ended up.
I would say either Izzy or Elon in the front. Maybe both of you, especially since
I can bring up the rear.
Okay, that's fine. I'll be nestled in the middle.
Yeah,
because we do. We need to, you know, the protection. Yeah. No,
I don't have the ability to fight blind.
That's nice.
Just wanted to let you guys know.
Look, I have a torch ready when we need it.
I also have
to illuminate so that we can get some light.
Sweeney, tell me another story because I'm bored again.
Ooh. All right, so one time I totally had sex more times than you have ever had in your life, so it's cool.
You already said that story.
I want one where I'm the hero. Okay, one time I hung out with really cool people and did a bunch of drugs while you... polished your armor for like 9 hours.
Is this based on a true story?
It's inspired by actual events.
He was telling me about it last night.
Yeah.
I gotta say, like,
I don't like these stories.
I have a story.
Okay, go.
Okay. There once was a beautiful man, and he had long blonde hair.
Go on.
And the hair would not stop growing. And it would just keep growing and growing. And so much that animals and people would flock to it and want to live in the hair. And at
like a kingdom of hair.
Yes, like a kingdom of hair. Because it just was attracting them. And so when the animals slept in them, they realized they slept.
Ow, my fucking leg!
Oh. Right. Oh, no!
Keep going.
There was no way to stop you from doing that. One could have seen that coming.
Do you have damage taken off of you for
Jeremy, over like the last several hours, you've taken damage. Like 2 damage.
All right, I'll take 2
not,
damage.
Not from that, not from bumping into that rock, but like, you know, this is a cavern. You've fallen off of a few things.
Okay.
I have like 5 torches. I just haven't been lighting
them. Used any
of ready to bust them out. I have like 3 in my hands so that when we get in danger, I can just...
Wait, I could just do a cantrip of produce flame.
This is fine. I think we're fine.
Wait, hold on.
I see a purple light up ahead.
Oh, wait. I have 10 torches.
And real quick, I'd like to get an idea. Elon, so you kind of pulled them here into the Underdark. How did you get them here? What was your form of travel, or how did you know where to go?
Well, actually, I was approached. I was doing my own thing about some business that I'd rather not talk about. I was traveling from town to town. And these guys actually approached me when I was at a pub, and they said to me,
"That sounds like us.
You look like the kind of guy who would know how to get into the Underdark." And I said, "All right."
Really, we said that?
I said, that's what you said.
Wow.
I said, "Look, guys,
profiling hard, guys."
We asked like 9 people per bar.
We kept saying that, and every time somebody
look,
got offended.
You guys were fully tanked when you came and asked me.
I wish all the scenes of you guys going to the same delivering the same line. You look like someone who knows how to get into the Underdark.
I'm a farmer.
I'm 11.
Guessed wrong.
I said, "Yo, you know, I'm really not interested. You know, I'm just doing my thing. I work better on my own." You guys said, "No, we really need help." So I said, "All right, what's the cost?" You said, "All right, I'll buy you drinks for the rest of the night." And you did. And I'm a man of my word.
And you drank like 500 gold worth of
That's all
alcohol.
My money.
I did.
What kind of alcohol was that?
And then drinking the best.
6 a.m. the next morning, I was up and I was ready to go. But you guys were so hungover. Awful. I was like, come on, you can't handle your liquor. And now here we are in the Underdark.
Does your god have a spell that cures hangovers?
I don't think I probably should have looked for one of those cards.
I think you could probably learn Greater Restoration.
Hang on a minute. Let me have a look what cards I have.
Is that an insult to your god of war to cure a hangover?
Maybe, I have maybe. Mending. Maybe. Does that apply?
I was actually looking at items. Resistance. Maybe resistance would have done that.
Alcoholic resistance.
Typically anything that like removes a poison is like...
Oh, okay. You know what? You do have that.
Purify food and drink. There you go.
Well, I don't want to lose my buzz. I want to be cured.
That's amazing. You could just be like, your drink is non-alcoholic and just bring it to someone for hours.
Protection from poison, from alcoholic poison. So yeah, look.
Okay.
Should I cast it? Did I cast
it? That was weeks ago.
That was a while ago.
Okay. I mean, I
unless
still
you guys
feel
did it.
It
last night
I
as well.
I still feel it. No.
No drinking on the job.
I'm drunk.
Oh, is
right
that
now.
Your rule?
That's yeah. my rule.
Oh.
We had fun. Now it's time to focus.
Well, because I have been drinking rosé every time we camp.
You have?
We are tanked yeah. back here. Yeah.
Well, no, I'm not
I wasn't
tanked
aware
now.
Of that.
I am.
Look, I wasn't aware of that. If I had have known
yes,
about
I am.
That.
Is it? Is your god... How's your god feel about drinking?
He's all for it, you know what I mean?
I mean,
we work yeah. hard. He knows when it's time to get the job done, we'll work hard. And then when it's time to kick back, you know, you got to reward yourself as well.
Who's your god for the audience?
Cleric of Moradin.
Oh, Moradin. That's, Moradin. I had a dwarf friend that was that worshipped Moradin.
You did?
I did.
Is friend the word?
No, he was a servant.
That's okay. what I thought.
I'm glad that you used that word first, though.
I've been
trying
to.
You are improving.
I've been trying to.
You know? Yeah,
I've been trying to see people as people.
And what happened with that? With the
I ordered him to get me sandwiches, and I haven't seen him for about a year.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Since Bahamas?
Since Bahamas.
But then again, we are in the Underdark, so you can't blame him. I mean,
well,
he could be back at your crib. He could be back at your house
right
now.
Here's the thing about Gormo is that he has always instinctively found me.
Oh, right, okay.
Whether
just
it's
behind you.
No. Gormo.
And as you guys are talking, off of your shield, you see a glint of that purple light the juncture catches your eye again. And you do hear some carriages rolling up, large caravans. You know that from the information that Elon has passed along and some of the ones you've gotten on your way, you know the best kind of main transport into the City of the Shaded Web are caravans. They come to this juncture point every now and then for traded goods, and they ferry those things back by caravan into the city.
And you're sure this is the way, Elon?
I am absolutely certain this is the way.
Elon, would it be better if we didn't look like a ragtag group of people from the surface? Should we look like drow?
Let's just keep our heads down, all right? No one's
gonna
be looking at us.
I mean, I can make us look like drow. Do we want to do that?
Yeah.
Wait a second. If this is a city of caravans, aren't there all types of people?
Be who you are, Sweeney.
Sweeney,
we've
been telling you to
happen?
Be who you are.
Yeah, but then I keep changing.
Yeah, well, that's true.
You keep changing because you keep dying.
Just don't die again.
Don't die.
Okay, I'll take that under advisement.
Also, by the way, since I did actually gain something when we leveled up here.
You might be the only one of us to do.
Stand back, you guys.
I just became more charismatic.
It's called Thousand Forms. And I can just...
What?
I can cast Alter Self at will.
Whoa!
That's awesome.
Will.
Whoa.
You know what that means?
Yeah, you can be the hottest version of yourself.
Yes! Huge knockers.
Yeah.
And a backside to pair with.
Yeah.
I can look like the Kim Kardashian of the underworld.
You know what? That is Kim Kardashian. That's just Kim Kardashian.
You know, that's actually what that was in my brain, too. Like, she would look so good down here with the blue light and the purple light.
She's a...
Shit.
She's a famous drow priestess.
Yeah.
Yes.
Hey, do they worship spiders?
Yes.
Loth is the most popular.
Okay.
She's a mother spider.
Oh, is that a goddess?
Goddess spider, yeah. So she's...
Hey, how's your god feel about Loth?
Moradin would not be a fan of Loth. Loth is a chaotic god. Knowing he has to roll, I'll just tell you. Loth, basically, as being a cleric, you might not know this, Horace, without
probably
rolling.
Don't.
But
you,
as a cleric, you would know this, and Izzy would know this. Okay. Loth is a chaotic god that resides in another plane called the Abyss. and she has like these great demon web pits and many demons that serve her, and she bequeaths the drow powers and gifts from time to time, but she is more of a darker, chaotic god than she is a... She's definitely not a good god, but she's also not like a lawful evil god.
I've seen paintings of her, and she is hot in those paintings.
I know, you like your anthropods. Right.
I absolutely.
Are you moving on from dragons to spiders?
You know, I don't know.
Damn.
I don't know. I'm open. I'm not giving up. I'm no longer. I'm in a place in my life now where if it comes.
Good. You know what that actually reminds me of when I think of Lolth? I do think of the stock from Saga.
That's true. She does look a lot like that.
Yeah. Yeah. She's got like a female torso, but a spider ass.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Okay.
I'm tired of holding your cape. I'm going to let go of it now.
Okay, but whenever you want to. It's all good.
At this point, you can see that like the light is casting enough from the juncture down there that you can probably, as you start to move ahead and get out from some of these stalagmites, you can start to see the path a little bit easier at this point.
Sweeney,
once you get out.
You're a handsome person now. You should accept that.
Okay.
I'm a handsome person. Let's walk in with confidence.
Yeah.
Okay,
I'm just going to take a little back step, let you guys walk in front of me, and I'm just going to... I'll be in the middle. Wait, right now. Let you guys lead if you
is
want.
Is Elon handsome?
I think he's... I sort of see like an Aragorn in like Lord of the Rings.
Well, that's
sort of
certainly like, handsome.
Yes, rugged, I mean, handsome.
He's like a ruggedly, just a warrior, yeah. Handsome. He's got some scars, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Just a rugged, traveling, leanly built handsome, because all he does is just walk all day and he fights and he's a battler.
Does Moradin have like a celibacy thing
as a cleric?
You know, I'd rather not disclose at this point.
Okay,
he's
a little forward, Horace.
Can I kiss you?
I'm trying to I like to keep it mysterious.
I'm gonna poke my head around and see what I can see. If it looks like this is a diverse kind of culture, if it's like the troll market from Hellboy 2 and we'll blend in, great. And if it's all drow, then maybe I'll use some magic and make us all look like
drow. Is there like a highway?
Oh, that's a good question.
So you peek around, you can see enough. You don't have to roll a perception for this. You see, looks like about six roads intersecting into this juncture point.
Holy cow.
And these are massive, large caravan roads. You see small caravans, you see horse and buggy kind of type from all different types rolling up from all different avenues of this juncture point.
Are they like paved?
Since you are in under stone and underground, they are well kind of smoothed. Mm. And as you get into this juncture point, you see varying different types of structures there. You see some tents and some mud-like stone structures. You also see some beautiful structures. Mm. So certain, you can imagine that certain denizens of the city, if they set up shop or trade here, they might have different establishments, much like different countries might have different embassies in a location.
Should we consider trying to get onto the back of one of these caravans? Maybe do like Indiana Jones and...
Oh.
We have to make sure we're going to the right place.
Right.
Six roads out of here.
We don't have to sneak on anything. All I have to do is ask, and they will respect my status.
Yeah, 50-50 shot of that being true.
Like a 20-80.
You know, honestly, one of my abilities is that I can... I have a position of privilege.
Yeah, it's on your character sheet. It's true.
It's on my character sheet. So,
it's not a thing.
We won't tell anyone that you were holding my cape about 10 minutes ago.
Well, of course you wouldn't. Because I wasn't.
Okay. Right.
No.
Agreed, everyone?
Yes.
Agreed.
The only cape I touch is my own.
Gross.
Good share.
We should just enter as is, as we are. What's
just
the worst
chilling
that can happen?
Yeah.
All right.
You want me to ask if we can catch a ride into town? It won't be asking. It will be more of an order.
Hey, Horace, follow-up question. What languages do you speak?
Let me think. Elvish. Draconic, of course.
Of course.
Because of Mom.
Yep.
And the one I'm speaking now.
Common.
Is that what they call it?
That feels out of character.
Oh, I have always known it as Kempian.
Oh my, that's funny.
That checks out. I speak Gnomish, Common.
Kempian.
End of line.
Common, Elvish, Druid, Halfling, Dwarf, Orin.
That's right.
Does Ron speak Elvish?
Yeah, Dad can speak Elvish.
Hey guys, I just want to let you know, I speak Undercommon.
Whoa!
That makes sense because you know the underworld
so well.
Yeah,
you guys,
well.
You know, approached me to
Undercommon.
To
Under Kempian.
Does Undercommon just sound like...
Do you call Undercommon Under Kempian?
Undercommon is Underdark, right?
Yeah.
All All right, maybe I should ask.
You would know, yes. Undercommon is the common speak of the Underdark.
All right.
If there is a common here, it is that.
Well, so, don't just ask them. Tell them. Tell them that I'm Prince Horace Kemp.
Hey.
And that I demand ride.
Prince Horace. Okay. So, look, the way I see it, we've got a couple options. We can just continue to walk in, try not to turn any heads. We could sneak in. That's like a third option. I don't really know if I like that. Or we could just ask someone. We could just go, yo, you mind if we get a...
Or... each one of us, one at a time, could go try something. It would maybe fail hilariously, and then every person gets a turn to do something. We'll see what happens.
That doesn't sound like what we normally do.
That's true.
I could turn into a bear. I'm going to turn into a bear.
That's never gone poorly for any of us.
I see now why you guys needed me to help you. You can't even...
We would have found our way.
Yeah,
we would have stumbled into this.
We tend to find our way towards just randomness.
Why don't you ask for a ride? Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't ask. Tell.
Tell.
Tell for a ride.
Tell for a ride.
I will do.
I'll come with you as a wingman just because.
I'll stand here against the wall handsomely.
Good call.
I could also become the heir.
So I'm walking up to the. I see there's a little carriage parked.
There is. There is a carriage off to the side. It looks like a few people from this distance. You're about 100 feet from them, kind of navigating through the stalagmites. You see the carriage is off to the side. It looks like they're fixing a wheel. The carriage itself and how far you are from this juncture point, this kind of miniature city, is only about, I'd say, 500, 1,000 feet. So it's far enough that it's pretty, like, if you were to think of it in terms of, like, a football field, like, it's about 2 football fields away. It's still pretty close. So
oh,
there's
the city
certain
itself?
Sounds. Yeah.
Oh,
the city
now we're
itself.
Just being lazy.
So
maybe we should just consider just walking.
Well, but here's the thing. We need to figure out how we get into the city.
That's true.
Maybe asking just like, hey, how do people get in? That's not a bad idea.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so you're walking up to the caravan?
Say,
are you stealthing or doing anything of, or just walking right?
I'm just
right
trying up? To play cool, you know, like just
okay.
Like in a neutral.
Yeah, good call. I'm going to turn invisible and just walk alongside you.
All right.
Okay. So
who is
Elon,
in the
are
carriage?
You really visibly wearing god stuff?
I think I've dressed down a little bit because I know in the Underdark, you know, I don't want to walk around like a target.
Right.
You know, I'm dressing down. I can...
like traveler's gear, essentially.
I can dine with kings nor lose the common touch. Let's
nice.
Just say that. So
nice.
The under common touch.
And by the way, in D&D, it's not football. It's rugby. So
right.
You're right. I'm so sorry. Field. You're right. The size of a rugby field.
Oh, good. Now we all of us Americans have a great mental image.
I played this sport. I knew stuff about it. All right, so...
So who is that there on the...
So, Elon, as you're walking up, you can see someone is hunched over. You can see a long white beard below their chin, but they're hunched, so you can't really make the size of them. You're about 50 feet away. Okay. As you're walking closer, you can see that this person or creature is a little bit smaller than you. Might be the size of, like, a dwarf or a really tall halfling. But as you're getting closer, you can see that this person's skin is more of a lighter gray color, like a chalky gray, maybe even a slight hue of pink in there. And you can clearly see a white beard, a bald head. He, and you can see now it is a he, is wearing black studded armor from top to bottom. You see at his side, while he is fixing the wheel, you see a large hammer to his right okay. that he set upon the ground as he is trying to fix it. You also hear him talking in what you recognize as undercommon sure. to someone else who seems to be at the front of the caravan, who is pulling on one of the pitch black horses and pulling on the reins to try to get them started again.
Okay.
So this is what you see 50 feet ahead.
So continue walking up.
I've got your back.
Thank you, brother.
But close, don't talk about
close.
Me.
Okay, you know.
So you're within close enough to like say something.
Yeah.
Do you?
Hey, brother. You're all right. You're all good. You need any help?
Are you saying this in common or in undercommon?
I'm saying this in undercommon right now.
So he quickly turns around and drops the wheel. The caravan shifts as he does and kind of tilts. The other one in the front goes ah, and like you know, as the whole caravan shifts, he quickly turns and grabs his hammer and faces you. Who are you?
Dude, look, I don't want any trouble with you, man. Like, I mean, obviously, we all know I could take this guy down if I need to take this guy down. But
are you saying that out loud?
I'm avoiding. No, I'm not. I mean, that's my thought. But I'm saying, hey, bro, like, I don't want no trouble. You know what I mean? Like, do you need help? Like, just calm down. I'm just trying to help you out.
As you're looking at him, you can see his eyes are a milky white. Okay. You don't see any darker pupil there. His eyes travel up and down your body.
Oh, you're a traveler. You found yourself a bit lost, have you? Picked up a few of the tongue, haven't you, on your trip?
Well, Yeah, I mean, I spent a lot of time down here, so I can speak in the Undercommon. Man, do you need help, or are you okay?
As you say this, he looks at you again.
How do you know our language so well? You said you spent some time here.
Well, I mean, I grew up here.
You're a slave?
No.
Not a slave walking around in such nice robes.
Look, dude, I just wanted to help you out with your wheel.
No, like I'd love your help, please. If you want to come aboard, we might have some business in town
going
for you
to
if you like.
You.
Well, I actually, I'm thinking maybe, you know, we could cut a little deal. I've changed a lot of these wheels before, so I could help you out with that. But I've got
he
some
spits
friends,
on
actually.
The ground and says, "You're not touch my caravan. You get in the back or you get the hammer."
Myself? Can I bring my friends?
What do you mean, your friends?
And he starts looking around the stalagmites. He bangs his hammer on the caravan. Another person of similar size, again, looks like a dwarf with gray skin, a little pink hue, white beard. This, not bald, he has kind of a more flowing mane coming off of the top of his head, pulled back into a tight bun with a leather strap.
Oh, these douchebags are Duragar.
Yep.
He hops off, and this one is also carrying another hammer and then a smaller hammer. A big hammer in the right hand and a smaller hammer in the left.
So this is escalating.
What have you found here? Oh my, look at this prize. You look nice, don't you? You want to hop on board? We're heading into town. Did somebody lose you?
So I'm going to turn around and look back at Horace and Izzy. What are you guys up to right now?
We were just watching. I was leaning against a stalactite trying to look pretty.
You don't see me because I'm now a swarm of bats.
What?
What? Okay.
Yes.
What?
Hang on.
Shit, yeah.
I have so many follow-up questions.
Wait, you just became a swarm of bats?
Yes.
Wait, okay, so where
are
you?
Do they have nice boobs and big butts?
I'm up there in the stalagmites.
Just hanging above?
Yeah.
You can become a swarm?
Yes, I can. A swarm. I could also become a swarm of insects, snakes.
You know, we're level 14. We're pretty badass.
That's true.
Actually, I could have done this as a level 1 if I had ever seen bats before.
Big deal.
And we've been down here for 2 weeks, so I know what bats
look
like.
I sense the timber, or it's up to you, DM. I sense the timber of the way this person's talking to my guide.
Mm-hmm. That sounds like an insight check.
It does sound like an insight check.
Okay. That's a
first roll of the day.
4+1. It's a 5.
You think this might be going well?
Ah, well, I'm gonna hang back and let him handle it because he seems like he's got it under control.
You hear Undercommon. You can't. So how you guys are perceiving Undercommon, by the way, is it sounds like it sounds like a heavily accented version of Common.
Oh.
To your ears. So it sounds like as if, you know, you would go to a part of the world and someone's got such a thick accent.
Scotland.
Like, okay, just sure. Like Scotland, yeah. And you
Liverpool.
Might hear, like, you can pick up some of the syllables and some of the words, but it's so accented, it's like a maze trying to listen to it.
Okay.
So, and they are speaking it very quickly. But yeah, you think it's going well.
Yeah, yeah. Looks like he's got it.
Izzy, you're above Sweeney. Would you like to roll insight, or are you just
that
chilling?
Seems appropriate. 6+5, actually. So 11.
Do you speak Undercommon?
No. I speak Gnomish.
Roll again. You have disadvantage on this check.
Checks out. That is way higher.
Okay. So with a 11,
yeah,
you can see by, and you can't really tell what they're saying, obviously, but
no.
By
the
one
second
guy hopping
guy coming
off the front,
out, yeah.
Holding his hammer, eyeing him kind of up and down, like both of them holding weapons, you can sense that things are not going great,
mm-hmm.
But it doesn't look like, you know, no one's about to kill somebody just
right.
yet.
I don't, at this point, sense that he is not in control of the situation.
Right.
It's just like, all right,
I'm very,
well,
very
these guys
control.
Are threatened. Actually, do we know what these are? Can I
you
roll?
You can roll for a history check if you'd like.
They look like dwarves, right?
They look like dwarves.
Yeah. 22.
Yeah, you know what these are. These are Duergar. Good. So, Duergar, I believe is how they're pronounced. Duergar.
Hey, Lon, what kind of weapon do you got hanging on, like, a sheath or whatever?
Oh, for our listeners as well, Duergar are underdwarves, essentially.
Yeah, they're evil. These are not, these are not like, man, they're just sad dwarves that live in the Underdark. Like, they are evil.
Slavery, right? That's
yes,
a thing?
They were enslaved by the Illithid. I can never pronounce the name correctly.
Illithid.
They basically, as people know them, as mind flayers. They were dwarves enslaved by them from the world above, and they were tortured for centuries. And then finally they broke free.
Don't feel bad for them yet.
They broke free, and they killed their masters, but then they just stayed and kind of started vying for powers with different other darker gods, and they've kind of just, they dug that hole and they just keep on digging like dwarfs do. But yes.
So Elon, what kind of weapon you got like visible on your body?
I got a whip.
Oh my god.
Just hanging off down like, whoa, Indiana Jones. Awesome. Hanging on my belt. I've got a great sword.
Whoa.
Which is,
what's that?
Great sword. Look.
What?
It's like a two-handed sword.
To my understanding, it's two-handed. You can't use a shield when you use it. But if you're like, look, if you're going out all out attack, the great sword is the one. Sort of like the Goron sword in Legend of Zelda, Ocarina of Time. I don't know. Do you know, is that what it was called? The Goron,
Goron sword.
The long sword?
Yeah, the big one.
You can't use your shield. Like when you had the Master Sword.
Do you make Link's sound as well when you swing it?
Yeah! Yeah! Height! Height!
That kind of thing.
Amazing.
That was awesome.
Moradin approves, right? Of that?
I mean,
I believe that's him.
I mean, he's like pretty proud of you.
He's like the smith god, so any weapons are pretty kosher with him.
Yeah, okay, but I mean, a big one is like super. He's like, dude, go for it.
Also, actually, I will say, Elon, you can roll to find out what these things are. I'd like you to roll with advantage because your god being Moradin, you would know about
this. And advantage means two.
You get to, you could get to roll your d20 twice and you take the better result.
So this one, I roll this one twice.
Yeah.
It's my first ever D&D roll.
So here we go.
Do I say the number I got?
Yeah.
Well, roll again. Let's see. Let's see which number you say.
What was the first one?
Which one is that?
That's a six.
Okay.
Six, and then roll again because you have advantage.
So
keep the six.
Put them both together.
Nope. You don't.
So what is your for history? Wait. Check your sheet. What's your history?
Okay.
Or actually, it would be religion. I would give you like religion for this.
Deny the religion.
Okay, they're actually both the same. They're both plus two. Five.
Plus five.
And so I go that's to six.
So it's 11. So you know.
Same thing.
So
I
you
got,
don't
yeah.
you don't know enough about them. You don't know, like Mike got a 22. You don't know about like all their past and slavery. But you do know that Duergar are kind of the slighted versions of dwarves, and that they Moradin is not necessarily. You would know the religious side. You don't know much about them, but you just know Moradin's not too pleased with Duergar.
Right. So in terms of me taking these guys down, I mean, it's all good. I mean, I've grown up with that, right? You know what I mean? Or like, god.
As far as your cleric honor? Yeah, sure.
You know what I mean? Like,
you've taken on Duergar before, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Because you've been to the Underdark.
Yeah.
Must we kill?
Nothing.
Every time. Wait, how many of them are there?
There are two. There are only two.
Only two? Well, I thought there were three.
Wasn't there someone at the reins?
That was the one that hopped off.
Got it.
Shouldn't kill.
We should probably kill the horses, too.
I'm thinking that we can...
The horse is light on fire
right now.
We could persuade and
look. I'm
run.
I'm thinking that I'm gonna take these guys down.
Oh,
all right. Honest. You go for it.
Shit. Well, your god is a god of war, so
yeah. You know
what
I mean.
That's a very good point.
And look, the way that these guys have been coming up at me is kind of a little bit disrespectful. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So I'm.
And they're evil.
They did call you slave.
And he might have a backstory
you're gonna go for
that
it.
You have personal vendetta against.
Yeah, exactly.
Are you going to attack?
I'm going to attack.
Okay, so you'll get for this since what is your dexterity?
Dexterity is plus three.
Okay.
Whoa.
Yeah. No, I would say you because they don't expect much from you. They're kind of ready with their weapons out. So actually, I think we will have to roll for initiative for this. I don't think you're going to get a surprise round on them just because they are kind of.
It's
going
to surprise me.
It will surprise you guys because you thought it was going really well.
Yeah, I think it's. Am I surprised by this too? Probably, right?
Yeah, you're surprised by this too.
So it's
just you. So you're going to roll your 1d20 and you're going to add your initiative bonus there at the top to the result.
Honestly, I kind of like the way you operate, Elon.
No bullshit. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I like this.
So I'm going to roll this. So close to a good one. I thought it was like half, like on the. Then it. Oh, no. So it's a four. So I got a plus three. So seven.
Seven. And they will roll as well.
Roll bad, roll bad, roll bad.
I roll all my bad eyes.
So they will go first.
There we go.
So they will go first. So, Elon, what do you do to show that you're about to fight? Like, what do you pull out as far as your weapon?
I'm putting my hand on my greatsword right now.
Okay, so they see your hand slide to your greatsword at your side, and they're quickly moving towards you.
I feel like your greatsword's probably on your back, right?
Yeah, like, okay.
Oh, yeah.
So, oh, yeah, yeah. So, we're resting it on my
it's
back.
Huge. It's huge. Great swords like, are...
That's pretty cool, right?
Great swords are about 5 feet long.
Oh, yeah, yeah. They're about as tall as a person.
Yeah, right. So, it's, okay. Yeah. So, I'm reaching for my great sword over the back of my my shoulder here, and I'm going to pull it down, and I'm ready to go. Two hands on the sword. I'm ready to go.
So, you see they waste no time and charge at you. Both of them, they're closing the distance. You're only about... probably 20 feet, maybe 15 feet away. As they're running towards you and you see their hammers at their side dragging behind them, you hear like a light crackling noise and like weird sounds, and you see their shoulders start to separate and move out a bit. You see their arms start to elongate. You see their legs crackle and they start to grow. You see them actually start to enlarge as they're running towards you.
Huh.
They were once maybe about 4 feet, 4.5 feet. They now, as they're approaching, look like they're gaining 6 feet and higher as they're running towards you. Hammers swinging and...
What the hell?
Ruh-roh.
All my bat mouth just open.
Let us not forget that Izzy is a like swarm of bats.
20 bat
mouths. 20 bats just like...
Can you turn into swarms? That's awesome.
Swarms, yep.
What is your AC? Should be right there in the town.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So 17 because I'm using both hands on the great sword.
So the first one comes up and swings, and you kind of step sideways, and his two hammers swing down and miss you. The other one comes in with its big one, swings once, misses, but catches the momentum to spin back around and hits you strongly with its hammer. As it connects, you're going to take 11 damage. Oh,
long.
Damn.
Mark that in there.
Yep.
Got that it. Is a solid hit.
All right, so now, Elon, it's your turn.
Okay, I'm going to focus on only one of them.
Okay.
The first one that came at me that missed me.
The one that missed you? Okay.
So I'm going to use the greatsword, and come on, give me some. Yes! I think that's good. I rolled an 11 plus 8, 19.
Nice.
Oh, yeah, you hit.
That's nice.
So roll.
Damage.
And roll for damage. So then, what is it, a D?
Okay. It's 2D6 plus 3.
Nice.
Okay, so 11 slash.
11.
Ooh. Nice. Right back. Right there. Back.
That's how we do things where I come from.
You and know you have another attack.
Eye for an eye.
I know what I'm doing. I'm going the Divine Strike.
Divine Strike?
Because I want to show, you know, this is the first time of battle in the Underdark, and I want to show you guys that I'm not messing around, you know what I mean?
Now, what does Divine Strike look like when you produce it?
So what happens is the sword actually starts to great sword shines really, really bright silver, and I swing down. Divine Strike for me actually happens in slow motion, but in real time, it looks really like crazy, like extremely, like just a really good swing through, you know what I mean? Like really good Divine Strike.
Nice.
Beautiful.
All right. So your like sword just starts to glow in silver light as you swing down.
That's it. And it's slow motion for me, so I can get that precision perfect. 6 plus 8.
Was that a 6 or not? Yes.
So 14?
Yeah.
Unfortunately, the 14 does miss.
Oh, no. Even in slow motion.
So that light... so beautiful. What happens is as your sword glows with that silver light, the Duergar kind of steps back as the light like kind of blinds him a bit, and you swing down, but he does step back to kind of get away from it, and you do miss him with that second attack.
Oh, man.
All right. So at this point, all three of you, Horace, Izzy, and Sweeney, have seen this fight just go down. I'd like each of you to roll for initiative.
I'm a little out of my depth right now.
No.
Nah,
you're a strong, independent woman.
All right. Horace, what did you get?
16.
See, I know I got backup coming in. That's why.
Izzy, what did the bats get?
10. Izzy.
Sweeney?
20.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
Okay, we're at the top of the round. Sweeney, you're first. You're invisible.
I am invisible. I'm going to cast fear on them.
Now, will that break?
It
will break, so you will appear.
Yep.
And they will be afraid.
Well, that's the hope.
I'm here, and they're like, oh, shit. Of a handsome man.
Of a half-elf that just appeared.
That man disappeared for 6 seconds, then reappeared, and I was fucking freaked out.
No, I was invisible for a while.
He's been invisible the whole time.
Oh, you have been.
Yeah. They've only seen Elon. They just think he's by himself.
Yeah. All right. I project a phantasmal image of the creature's worst fears, each one in a 30-foot cone, so I'm going to not hit Elon, because I'm aiming it at the two of them. Must succeed in a wisdom saving throw.
Awesome.
Take that.
If they fail, things happen. If they succeed, that sucks.
Okay, here we go, both of them.
If they succeed, they just get stronger.
The one on the left that hasn't been hurt yet by Elon got an 11.
Not enough.
So they fail. And the one that has been hurt got a 17.
Not enough.
Oh, okay. Wow. Your DC save is
18. I knew that was
what
coming.
What is it?
So they both, feel the fear. So do you see what the fear is or just them?
I don't know. I feel like I might know what they're seeing, but...
Because you're casting it, you might get a view of it.
Yeah.
Elon and the rest of you probably don't see this.
No. So they must each drop what they're holding and become frightened for up to 1 minute, okay. As long as I maintain concentration. They must take the dash action and move away from me by the safest available route on each turn. If there's nowhere to move, then they just kind of get to where they don't have line of sight of me. If they're in line of sight of me, they just have to keep moving. They just keep running.
Okay. So on their turns, they will move.
On their turns, yeah.
Got it.
I have a feeling they see male vulnerability. Like that yeah. They have to share their feelings.
Oh, yeah. Or their masters. Yeah.
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 Or that.
Yeah, that's...
I like male vulnerability.
I can tell you what they see. They, as you're looking, you see in front of them, like, out of, like, as if a torrent of flame appeared, fire blows in front of them, and fiery tentacles of the face of a mind flayer appears before them, tentacles reaching out in flame at each of them. And the thing is, this happened a long time ago. Duergar have been free for a long time.
Oh.
So whatever they're seeing is what they've been told in, like, children's stories. Like, you cannot imagine. That's why this is not a per-size mind flayer. This
not
is
not accurate.
Like, I knew this guy. It's, yeah. Like, what they perceived as a child, what a mind flayer must look like. Large, great, with fiery tentacles. And that's what they see.
Creepy.
Cool. That's my action.
So, Horace, it's your turn.
I'm going to immediately charge in, because...
And how fast can you move?
Nobody fucks with my...
You're in the dark.
Your buddy?
My guide.
Oh, is it still... No, there's light from the...
So he can see some light.
30 feet.
30 feet. Yeah, you can make it there. So...
Like black feet. Light? Like
yeah, you can close enough. They moved up closer. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can make it there. You can see a little bit better at this point because, mm-hmm. especially by the caravan, they have some light purple lights hanging off of the edge of their caravan, which is kind of casting this in a purpley hue. So you can see that as you're moving up, but that's... kind of the only piece of light you guys actually have, just to kind of set the scene a little bit more. It is a very dark spot. Actually, except for the glowing silver light emanating off of Elon's blade. You see that as well.
Hell yeah.
So, Horace, go for
okay,
it.
Okay, okay. I'm going to roll. So, I charged up.
Mm-hmm.
In my head, I'm, like, already super into my guide. Because he's, like, just... I was, like, they didn't even... He didn't even hesitate.
He was just I'm loving like, this. It's time to yeah, go.
I'm loving this. Okay. So I get three attacks. And
which one are you attacking first? The one that's
the one
been
that's
hurt?
Closest to okay. Yeah, that's been hurt and mm-hmm. is closest to Elon.
Take him down one by one.
I'm sure I hit with like a 20 something.
Yeah, you do.
And then 17?
17 does hit as well.
Okay. And I rolled a one. But that was my last swing.
Well, natural one. So on this show, Elon, whenever somebody rolls a natural one, I like to let them decide because that's a critical failure. So what happens when you critically fail?
So I did 23 damage.
To the one that he hit?
Yeah.
And that was with the two different attacks?
Yes.
And he'd already taken 11?
Yeah, he'd taken from Elon
already. So I did 23 damage. And then on my third strike, I tried to look over at Elon and wink. And
as you swung again.
But accidentally closed both my eyes and fell. Because I actually don't know how to wink. Nobody ever taught me how to do it.
Right.
You close both you and just blink.
Yeah. Yeah, I thought it was a long blink.
So you're prone now.
And to me, it just looks like you fell asleep.
Yeah, actually, like, maybe of narcoleptic.
And I'm like, did this guy just fall asleep in the middle of battle?
Yeah. Moradin probably is not into that. Like, that's bad. Bad in the
bad
gods.
Form. Yeah, that's
not poor form.
Yeah.
But you got two really good swings in before
okay.
that happened.
Okay.
And as these two swings hit this Duergar, it looks pretty real bad. Like, you definitely cut off this was the one that had the two hammers. You definitely cut off one of those arms.
Whoa!
Yeah, and pinkish, purplish blood pooling down out of his body onto the ground below, and eyes just wide of shock as he's looking down at his severed arm on the ground next to him. He looks real messed up.
He's also still afraid.
Yeah. Oh, I mean... He's probably connecting this, like, you kind of probably looked like one of the fiery tentacles of the Mind Flayer as you swung out at him, and it looks like, my parents told me this would happen.
Yeah.
So.
If you become a merchant that steals from people, the Ithalids are going
to
get you.
They're going to rip off your arm. Guys, we haven't had enough adventures where we've gone back to the minds of the people you guys are killing.
Just really explore their PTSD.
Yeah. So, it's their turn. And they are going to run in fear for obvious reasons.
If they get out of line of sight, they can try to make the save again.
So they're going to try to dash around the caravan, but they are leaving right next to Elon and Horace. So both of you will get an attack of opportunity against them, which means you get to make a single attack.
They also, and specific in the description, they drop whatever they are holding.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. The hammers, well, one of them doesn't have to because his arm's on the ground now.
I probably don't because I'm laying on the ground.
As a character that is prone... Let me just
I think it's a disadvantage, maybe.
Whenever I think of prone, I just think like
no, you do. You're you have disadvantage. So you will still get an attack. It'll be a disadvantage. So that means roll two die, take the lower. Elon, just roll one attack. Okay. So whenever you're doing attacks, you'll roll the big
one. Boy, oh boy.
What'd you get?
This is my, actually, the senior number that I played with when I played soccer in senior year. I rolled a 16.
Ooh.
Nice.
Plus 8.
Lucky number 16.
Well, that'll definitely
it's
hit.
It's probably one of my favorite
We call numbers, it football in America.
Yeah, football. Yeah, soccer, you know what I mean. Yeah.
What's happening?
I've always liked that.
All right, Elon, roll for damage. Now, which ones were you guys attacking? Because both of them are fleeing, and both of them are next to you.
The closest one to me.
The one that you chopped up?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Oh, so I got a 6. I rolled a 2, a 1, and plus a 3.
Which one were you swinging at, Elon? The one that was injured or the one that hasn't been hit yet?
Oh, man. I kind of feel like a bad guy if I say the one that was injured now.
No, don't.
No, I'm going to go
for... Leave that at the door.
All right. I'm going to go for the one that hasn't been hit yet, just to smack him up a little bit. You know what I mean?
So Morden's like into honor. He's like, fuck up the people that haven't been fucked up
yet. Yeah. So that, the other guy's down. Quality. He's not a threat.
That one's turning, and your great sword cleaves him across the back as he goes, but he continues to sprint around the caravan, while Horace, the one that is running away from you, finish him.
Oh, because, why, you saw what I rolled?
I didn't know what your damage was, but I can tell you he was low enough that I think just your bonus kills him.
Oh,
just
in damage. Okay. I catch his Achilles heel.
Oof.
So he goes down, and then I claw my way up his body.
Oh, God.
And then put doors through the back of his skull.
Nice. Beautiful.
So your sword is just deep in the stone ground right now.
Well, I went upwards, so it went on his face.
And I'm like, man, who's the warrior here? Me or Horace?
I'm the warrior.
Yes, you are.
And
you're our warrior.
Damn, if Horace didn't come and save me just then, I was in trouble.
I have a kingdom, you know.
Right. I think we're actually going to get along really well.
So, Izzy, it's your turn.
I poop. They seem to be taking care of the fight below me.
You're
very
not as much
well.
Fighting as you are relieving yourself.
As I am just like, yeah.
Here's the thing. How many opportunities do you have to poop out of like 20 different buttholes?
Not many.
I feel like I'm never going to have
an experience
you
should all appreciate at some point.
Yeah.
All right, Izzy. So is that you just crap on the one remaining door guard below?
Like tiny little like shit rain.
Cool. And he's like, man, I would have rather get stabbed. You know what I mean?
For fun, it covers the ground around where he's running, and he's dashing, so he's not expecting this. I'm going to have him roll a deck save, and if he fails hard, I'm going to have him slip.
Yes.
Insult to injury.
Slip in my
back. Oh, my God, he rolled a 2. So, yeah.
Oh.
The Quano just carpets the ground around him. He's still terrified because he saw his friend just get brutally murdered by what he can assume is a Mind Flayer minion, and then just slipped on the bat guano and has fallen prone on the ground.
I improperly wink at the bats.
The bat smile.
All right, Elon, it's your turn.
Okay.
Your foe has just rounded around the caravan, and you've heard a loud thud as he's hit the ground.
Okay, and the other guy is down, and he's injured.
Oh, the other one is
gone.
Dead.
Oh, no, right.
There's a sword through his face.
Okay. Should we just let this guy go? You know, should we restore some kind of... just let him get away with it. You know, he got shat on. You know, it's bad enough for him.
Nobody gets away.
Okay. We need to make a statement. Because let's not forget, we're only 200 feet from the town.
What a dark, honest moment about this world.
Nobody gets away. We're only 200 feet from the city. The Underdark town, city there.
I'm sure they've seen shit like that.
We want to make a statement.
You guys are still about 1,000 feet. You guys
are about 1,000 feet. Okay.
I don't know what the total of 2 rugby fields add up to, but it's
that's
not 1,000.
That's what makes it such a great unit of measurement.
They're not that fit. Yeah, no.
We got this.
All right, let's take him down. So I'm going to actually... So what's the distance?
So he hasn't gotten far enough. He's probably about, because he dashed, he would have gotten 50 feet.
Oh, no. I'm going to go javelin.
All right. How far can you move?
Nice.
I'm going to use my javelin, which
Holy
is,
shit, that's cool.
To my understanding, it's good with 30 feet, and then it says up to 120 feet with disadvantage. So,
But you can run twice, around the caravan, and then you'll see him, and you can throw it.
Oh, you also have the light crossbow, which is a range that I did not write down, because I'm a
bad
friend.
He's probably better off throwing the javelin.
You think I should keep
Well, here's the thing. The javelin is a javelin of lightning, which you can use once a day.
Oh.
So your movement speed, you can run 30 feet, and then you can throw the javelin.
All right, so I'm going to do that.
Just so you're aware of the options, the range on the crossbow is 80 feet. So you wouldn't have disadvantage.
Oh.
Save that javelin for when
he
we fight.
He would still have to move because the Duergar has run around the caravan to the other side to get away from all of you.
That's true.
So
if he can't see me, he can make the save again.
True. He can, sure.
Crossbow.
I'm
he fails.
Okay, cool.
Okay. So am I going crossbow?
It's up to you.
Save your javelin. If you can do that once a day, save that for
Yeah,
for
usually sure. save things for like when you really need it.
And this isn't a situation where I really need it?
Yeah. Nope, no. We instigated
it. I mean, how are you feeling?
We got this.
Yeah. His hammer is also 50 feet away.
I'm going to pick him off, with the crossbow. So, okay. And I roll a 17.
Nice. Whoa. You will hit. So you round the caravan, you spot him. Actually, you can roll again because you have advantage because he's prone. Wait.
Because if he gets a natural 20.
No, ranged attack. It's ranged attack, so you actually have disadvantage. So roll a second time. And take the lower
16. There's that number again.
Just as fine anyway.
Look at him at 16.
So you see you see a Duergar lying on his back, covered in like white bat droppings, just staring up at the ceiling, his face filled in horror and nightmare, because he still hasn't broken out of the fear check that Sweeney is holding on him. And Elon, you throw your javelin, roll for damage. Oh, wait, is it crossbow or javelin?
It's just gonna crossbow. Do his crossbow.
Oh, crossbow. So you fire your crossbow at him. Nice.
And I roll to see
roll your damage.
Oh, man, I'm lethal. Eight. 8 out of 8.
8 plus 3.
Nice.
Yeah.
So 11.
Damn.
I am playing. I don't.
So your crossbow sticks him right in the side. He grabs it in pain. Still alive, but it looks like he's turning, kicking his legs in the air. It looks like you hit a vital organ.
I definitely hit a vital organ there.
All right. Sweeney, it's your turn.
All right. I am going to walk around the corner and cast a magic missile at him.
Casually? Okay. You're just going to casually walk around the
corner. Just flick your fingers.
We've gotten really badass.
Oh, I'm doing nothing. That's I'm not even breaking a bat
sweat.
She just
took down a Duergar, knocked him prone.
That's how badass we are. Is that you're just bats, and we're doing fine.
Hey, guys, I just want to just raise one fact that we still need to figure out how to fix the wheel.
Oh, yeah, we're getting nothing out of this
fight.
You know what I mean?
No, we're just having fun.
Well, hey, we'll get the carriage to
in
there.
You have mending. You can fix the wheel.
Yeah, okay, good call.
We just need to go like one football field, you guys.
No, I want that card.
It is going to be 12 damage from the bolts of magic missile.
Okay.
Wait, are there ponies with the card?
Yeah, we get the ponies.
Oh, shit. Worth it. Ponies.
We need stealth because we can't just walk up to the gate. We need to go in.
Yeah, we need to go in
and
as
how many
merchants.
Missiles is that, Sweeney?
Three missiles.
So 1, 2, 3, you hit him head, side, legs. It looks like he was trying to stand up. One of the missiles clipped his hand. You see it fire right through his hand and blow out his palm. He collapses back onto the ground as the other two missiles hit him in the face and the side right next to where the first crossbow is in. He looks real messed up. Like, he's moving his other good hand around in what is just now just white bat guano on the ground, trying to get up, his pink and purplish blood mixing with it. It looks bad.
Pink, purple, and white. Pretty pastel color.
Yeah, very nice. Horace, it's your turn. So I probably can't complete this painting.
I probably can't reach him because I have to stand up first.
You will, yes.
So here's the thing. I can probably hit him with a hand axe, though, right? Mm-hmm. If I stand up and walk over.
What's the range of your hand axe?
Well, it's thrown, so I actually don't know.
10,000 feet.
It's like 20?
10,000 feet. Yeah, 10,000 Izzy said 10,000
feet. Oh, 10,000 feet. Oh.
Yeah.
Well, if it's 10,000 feet.
Like, you know, Mammoth Mountain.
I honestly don't know 5th edition rules.
Range of the hand axe is 20 feet. Up to 60 feet.
So you would still have, but the thing is, you would still have to go around the caravan, but you have two, you can stand up and then you would move. Do you have a bonus attack?
Or I have 3 attacks.
Well, remember, but standing up is half your movement.
Is it half or is it all of your movement?
It's half.
Oh, so you can't make
an
attack after standing?
15 feet.
You would be able, if you're 15 feet, that's enough to get around to the side to see him, and you can throw your action there. Yeah. I was just saying he is directly blocking your line of sight.
Okay.
The caravan is.
So I have 2 hand axes, and I'll throw both. Just
disadvantage with these, because it's...
Oh, disadvantage?
Disadvantage, because he's prone still.
Uh-oh. 11? No.
That won't hit.
Okay, second hand axe. Well, no, that won't hit either.
That won't hit. No,
I just lost both my hand axes.
So two axes.
Throw them into the abyss.
And just ting, ting, ting. Just bouncing off of.
I look over at Elon, like, I don't normally throw those.
Okay.
Right. So now
you just did so well before, and then you.
And now it's the Duergar's turn. He's going to. He stands up out of the goop around him. He has to deal with the fear and try to break out of it. He does not.
Well, he actually doesn't get to save now because I'm in line of sight again.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So he then still makes sprint and he just starts running. He's not running towards the junction because you guys kind of came from a pass point. He is basically running deeper into the stalagmites on the other side of the road. Just like without thinking, without thought, he is just trying to get away from danger and he dashes again another 50 feet into the weaving tree line of these stalagmites. So at this point, he is almost out of line of sight for all of you. So now, Izzy, it's your turn. You can still see him because you are above. You can kind of see him making his way through the maze of stalagmites on the other side. What do you do?
Maybe we should let him go.
You guys talking to yourselves? Oh, to them. Oh, to.
Oh, are you saying that as bats?
Yes.
I don't know if my animals can't talk to you. We've established that since episode one.
So you squeak at us.
You're right. We should finish him off. He can't spread our word of our arrival.
If I know Izzy, she's telling us to finish him off.
I'm gonna pop out of being that bat.
So all the bats swarm into an Izzy?
Yeah, like a Batman.
Awesome.
Like how Batman stands first.
That's not what that movie's about at all.
That's what that movie's about.
Oh.
Now, do you do it mid-air and then drop as Izzy, or do you the bats come to the ground and settle as you?
The bats come together and start to form a tight bat tornado, and then from feet to head, I reappear.
That's cool. Yeah. That's cool.
Like the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
And I say, hey, guys, maybe we should just let him go. He's running. He's running real fast, real far. Look at him go.
I think you got the message.
Dang.
Nobody gets away.
I wish I could run that fast.
Not from the Velvet League.
Well, you know what, Horace? We've never let anyone go.
Exactly.
That's not true. We did let someone go. They came back and they killed me.
That's right. Oh, that's why we don't let people go.
Yeah.
That's a good call.
And also, he could have children that will come find us in 30 years.
That could be true either way.
That's true of everybody that we've ever killed. That's so true. We'll cross that bridge when we get there.
Well, one less Duergar child to find me.
I don't want to run and go get
Dad
him.
Always says that assassins come from children. In that, the end.
That's true.
Dad says that's why you kill children.
I like that.
Whoa, what?
Not that you kill children. You gotta cut that part out. No, I mean, I like that assassins come from children.
Not you. No, you're fine. What?
You know what I mean?
Did Marcus...
Asked Dad one time why you kill children. That's why he said it.
To prevent revenge.
Hang on, pause. Yeah. I'm going to cast a firebolt at the Duergar, range 120 feet, and just finish this guy off.
Are you going to move a bit? Because he's weaving through stalagmites.
Yeah. I'll move forward.
All right. So you're going to roll disadvantage for this.
Because he's... how far away is he? He's only 50 feet.
He's only 50 feet.
Does he have half cover? Or?
The thing is, that's the thing. He has some cover. So it's just his increase to his AC. Yeah. Because he's weaving through stalagmites right now.
20.
17 plus 10, 27.
Yeah, I don't even need Woo! To... Yeah, you hit him, definitely. It finds like...
Damage is 3d10. Do you want me to roll it?
Yes, please.
Wow. 3d10.
It's like 3.
It is, in fact, 21 damage.
Oh, burn.
Shit. Oh, burn. Does it just explode?
Literally burn.
Burn, literally. Yes, finish him.
There's just this bolt of fire that comes from my hand. It just goes right through him, and I turn around and I go, your dad kills kids?
Yeah.
You know, it didn't sound right
so
to me
off,
either.
So, like, if off camera, it's framed as Sweeney is on the right-hand side, Horace is on the left-hand side, and in between the two of you in the distance, you can see through the fuzzy stalagmites, you see a light, like, out of focus, so wee, and you just see it hit, fire light up, and pink explosion in the background.
You know, it never sounded right when he said it to me either, so maybe in my kingdom, we won't kill children.
I like that. Also, speaking of your dad, where are we spending Christmas this year? We gotta figure
that out. You mean Bahamutmas?
Bahamutmas.
Well, that's what he celebrates.
You know, if we can't get home, we can't get home. It's fine. That's true. Sometimes I will just light a couple Bahamutmas candles and, you know,
yeah,
celebrate by myself.
As you guys are standing there, I'd like each of you to roll perception for me. Horace?
Oh, that wasn't my best work.
What did you get?
I got a 20.
Izzy, what'd you get?
Can't do math. 14.
Sweeney, what'd you get?
17.
Elon?
I rolled a big number. I rolled a 2. Plus 3.
So you got 5.
Yeah.
Okay. So all of you are kind of engaged in this like conversation and surprise about Horace's background and like what his father had opinions on, except for Horace, because, you know, he knows this. And Horace...
Horace, I feel like, is always 1 foot out of our conversations anyway. Yeah.
Horace hears behind him, he hears horses and he hears yelling and sounds coming towards you.
I hear horses, yellings, and sounds.
What?
Coming
what?
Toward us.
Where?
I'm going to reach into my pocket, pull out my deck of illusions. Not doing anything with it yet, just
okay.
Ready in action.
Do you guys turn to the direction to see what is coming towards you?
Yes.
So, Horace, you turn around and you see coming up, and it's still far enough away that you can't exactly perceive it, but it looks like three humanoid figures riding atop pitch-black stallions racing towards your direction.
Does it sound aggressive, or how does it...
They're moving very quickly towards you, but you still can't clearly see them. They're about 500 feet away.
Okay.
You can see what look like humanoid features, mm-hmm. like arms and legs, but you can't perceive like race or gender or anything like that.
Hide!
Can I cast a spell?
If you want.
Oh, God.
What do you have in mind?
I'm immediately going to cast Mending and fix up that wheel.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
So the wheel just, you see, it clacks against the bottom of the caravan. The caravan almost unnaturally raises as the wheel snaps into place and the wood mends as if it had never been cracked before.
All right, guys, real quick. Do we want to be Duergar?
Everybody get in the caravan. Everybody be quiet. I'm going to turn into a Duergar. Because I can.
Okay.
That's right. Izzy can just do it at will now.
Okay.
Do you speak the language? Here. Elon, you're going to be one too. We're all going to be Duergar. All
right.
Okay.
I don't speak the language though.
No, it's cool. We're going to... Hang on. You be a Duergar. We're your slaves.
Yeah.
All right.
Done. I'm going to cast Seeming on him. He's going to be...
I don't know how I feel about being a slave.
I don't care. So I'm going to cast Seeming on all of us. We are all going to look... The three of us are going to look like... tattered versions of ourselves that
I'll
have
be a
been
a friend of his.
Okay, fine. You rationalize it however you want to, Horace. We'll have that conversation much later. And by that I mean probably never. We're gonna look like ratted versions of ourselves that look like, wait, we've been in the Underdark dark for weeks. We look pretty ratty right now anyway.
I look good.
Okay. I'm gonna make him look dirty.
Your knees are just filled with dirt and you're kind of covered with some Duergar blood right now.
Oh god.
And bad guano.
I'm beautiful.
I'm just going to make all of us look a little more ragged and a little bit more, you know, a little more hopeless.
Okay. And so then, some bags under the eyes,
yeah.
Like dark rings and things like that. A little bit emaciated.
And I'm gonna make our good friend Elon here look like a Duergar. Now, Seeming's limit is I can make him about a foot shorter.
Okay.
So that's not really Duergar height. Like, you're not 4 foot or anything. You're not 5 feet tall. You're like six something.
Yeah.
Well,
six.
Sweeney, you rolled a 20 when you were doing your check. So you know that Duergar can, from your check, you know Duergar can enlarge and shrink themselves.
Okay.
At will.
He's a him-sized Duergar.
Okay.
No chains on us, but collars.
Okay. Do you guys hop in the caravan or you're staying?
Yeah, let's climb in.
Yeah.
Okay, sure. Elon, where do you position yourself on the caravan?
I'm gonna just so I see that the wheel's been fixed. I'm gonna walk around to the other side of the so obviously I need to be outside. The slaves on the inside of the caravan.
What do you guys do about the bodies? The one body right next to the caravan.
I'm gonna lean out and say, something killed them, not you.
There's one deeper in the stalagmites far away that you blew up, basically, but there is one right next to the caravan on the ground.
Ooh.
With a, you know, that has a big Doris-shaped
slash in its face. Hang on.
Elon knows enough about the Underdark to know what could kill somebody accidentally here.
Yeah. See, it could have been any number of things.
Right.
Not necessarily us.
It doesn't have to be us.
Got a couple of ideas.
You know, if they don't ask, we don't have to say anything.
Yeah. Don't ask, don't tell.
You didn't get a good look at it. Maybe. I don't know. It's your call, man.
Can we put invisibility over him?
I can cast invisibility on a creature. I don't know. It's a DM ruling whether creature has to be alive for me to do that.
You can absolutely cast it on a dead body.
Done. He's invisible.
Okay.
You're the Duergar.
I was going to say, like, I'm not going to, just because, like, blood doesn't make the difference.
All right. We are burning through Sweeney spell slots, guys. Okay. So let's.
So as you're all positioning yourselves, getting into the caravan, Elon, you're getting at the front. You're grabbing the reins.
Invisibility lasts for an hour.
The horses start to kick a little bit as you pull on the reins because they don't recognize you. And you see three horses come into view. Now some of you in the caravan peeking out can start to see, and Elon, you can certainly see them as they're riding up. These are three drow. The front being led by a drow female with beautiful silver hair pulled back behind her in a braid. You see kind of a warband armor on the front, but the rest of her look like clothes and robes hanging off of her. You see dragging behind her by at least 5 feet are two male drow riding. Each of them seem to have a long sword at each of their sides. Their armor is very well polished. It is a darker kind of silver color. It looks silver, but is of a darker tone. Their hair looks pristine and nice. Again, long white hair flowing down to their shoulders.
I'm going to elbow Izzy and be like, are you saying this? Now that's,
man,
that's queen material right there.
I hope my hair turns silver. My mom says it might happen, but
that is queen material.
I know. Look at her outfit.
Imagine her as my queen.
What? You like drown now?
Yeah, but I always have.
No.
Although we've never really met any.
We met one.
Yeah, we did. Yeah.
Like way back in the day.
And I loved it. I loved every minute.
She is pretty hot.
So she rides up and comes to you and announces herself. What is this? What has happened?
Hey, I just thought that I saw the wheel was breaking off. I just walked around to check it out, but it's actually fine. So I'm just getting back into the carriage right now. We're just going to head on into town.
We heard the sounds of attack. Is everything okay? She peeks her head to the left and looks inside the caravan and sees all three of you.
I'm gonna nod my head and be like, hey, what's up?
Oh,
she narrows her eyes at you and looks back at you.
I'm sorry about him. Maybe it wasn't an attack, but I was just telling Horace, my slave, to just calm down. He gets a little bit out of line sometimes. Yeah, his name's Horace, yeah. I was just telling him because sometimes
she leans over and looks at Horace, narrows her eyes again. That's cute.
Thank you.
I think she just said something nice about me.
I think she did too.
What is your name?
My name is Elon.
Elon, are you coming through passage to the cross today?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you have your papers?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, make sure to show it to the guard up front. We want to make sure there aren't any unwanted caravanners coming through here. I am...
He visibly goes, oh, yeah.
I thought the next question was, can I see your papers?
I know.
It's like going immigration.
I was like, well, yeah, sure. Let me just roll through the pockets of this nothing on the ground.
I keep my papers in an invisible dead body near me.
Okay, you know when you if you have a couple of drinks, like a couple of nights ago, you come up to like a dry...
A DUI
like
the, check.
Yeah, DUI. That's how nervous I got. Yes. I was like, yes.
Make sure you have your papers ready. I am, of course, if you have any questions, Clev Devsepta of the Third Strand. I'll be in town if you have... Please keep safe on these roads, though.
Thank you, ma'am.
We want to be aware at all times, especially these days. Be well. And she kicks her legs against the side of the horse, pulls back. The other two drow follow behind her, and she rides back towards the town.
Izzy, did you hear how she pronounced all that nonsense? Yeah. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
That was close, but mm-hmm. We did a good job there. We got away with that one.
Did you put in a good word for me?
Yeah, absolutely. She said she thought you were cute.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Are you guys hearing
this? We've never heard that, too. So this is blowing
what
my
mind. What do
you
mean you've never heard that?
No one's ever outwardly said, well, she thought the fact that I think it was your name is cute. Your name is
Horace.
Cute.
Well, a lot of women normally don't say cute. They normally say handsome. They normally say powerful.
Get away from me.
that was
stop talking.
A couple times.
Not interested.
Busy.
Not interested.
I'm going to be busy.
Well, normally, when a woman says get away from me, they mean get away where I can view you better.
I have a
too
headache.
Close up, it's hard to see.
I don't know where I'm at this point in my life.
You repulse me.
Right. You repulse me to an area where I can watch you from a distance and admire you. That's what that means.
You would be having sex.
Maybe it is
a
different language.
Jeez. I'd rather hump a loofah.
Don't touch me. I'd rather hump a loofah means she doesn't want to despoil my body because it's so pure.
You smell like a nail salon. I want to be as far away from you as possible.
Right. That's like,
these were just some of the more common things, but never cute.
You know what? I do smell like a nail salon.
You do.
Elon, I'm going to need you to make a animal handling check.
Oh, he has to handle me?
He has to handle you.
We'll go right ahead. You look like a kitty.
Automatic 10, brother.
To get these horses to obey you, basically. Pulling on the reins at this point. Okay. You'll have to basically roll a d20 and then add the animal handling bonus to it.
Okay.
Or negative. I don't know what it is.
Okay. Positive. 3 positive. And I roll a 15.
Nice. So 18. You have pretty
You've
good.
You've worked with horses yeah. before.
Right? These horses kick up a little bit. You tightly hold the reins like a, you know, like a trained, you know, rider, and they respond quickly. Their feet settle back onto the ground, and they move under your command.
You would fit well at the Kemp Estates, you know.
Yeah, I told you I spend a lot of time in this world. You know, what can I say?
You should join my kingdom.
We'll talk about that at a later stage. You know, just want to get the job done for now.
Yeah, horse. You can't just ask people to be part of your kingdom.
But I will say that you did fight well.
Wait, hold on.
You did fight well.
We need papers.
Oh, let's grab the invisible body.
Sweeney, you go through the invisible
body. Hey, we should
probably
grab the invisible body and throw it in the bag in case anybody comes stumbling along and runs.
Yeah, let's just bring it. Let's keep it invisible for now, but let's have it.
Unless we get searched.
It's invisible.
We've got, like, how long do we have? 57 minutes left?
Yeah, we got some time on this.
Man, you're really good with time.
All right, thank you.
Watches don't exist in our world, and you're like on the minute.
The sundials don't operate well in the Underdark.
This guy's got an internal clock.
All right, so you guys grab the invisible body. Pilfer through the invisible body. If you take a few minutes, like you find there.
Honestly, it'd take more than a few minutes to pilfer an invisible body. Yeah.
I'm making an investigation.
You check that body. You check that body. You find some pieces of silver, some pieces of gold. About a total of 5 silver pieces and 12 gold pieces
on
the body.
Jay. Are those invisible?
They are invisible.
How do I fucking know it's silver and gold?
They're in that, so the body.
You're noble,
so,
you can tell.
That's true. I clink them together.
Well, once they're not on the body.
Here's the concept of invisibility. Is invisibility just the skin level? And then when you, like, the pocket
once
is
you
invisible.
Remove something.
But once you pull it out of the, like, is the pocket invisible or is literally every cell and thing touching this thing's body invisible?
No, I think
I asked the wizard. I asked the wizard.
Oh,
what is your invisibility?
Yeah, ask the wizard.
Is it every cell in its body? I don't think it's going to say that on the on the magic.
Anything the target is wearing or carrying is invisible as long as it is on the target's
there
person.
There you go. Ah. So you don't know. This feels like metal. This feels like coins.
Well, once I take it and it's mine,
it's off his person.
Oh, okay. Then there you go. So you pull it out, you can see that it is a 12 gold pieces and 5 silver pieces.
Yeah,
but you don't, on this body that was by the road, you don't find any papers on him.
Crap.
The other guy.
It's the exploded one.
We blew him up.
So you go down and you check the remnants of the body that is now down there that it has been blown up.
Actually, I'm going to say, hey, guys, just check the cart just in case he left anything there.
Okay.
Maybe been idea. Like he left in the front seat.
Hey, Sweeney, how long am I going to look like a ragamuffin?
Just 8 hours.
Oh, God.
You do find...
No, I mean, I think that would be a good, pretty good way to actually get into town.
Yeah.
Yeah.
On the parts of the body, you pilfer through some pieces of arm and leg. You do find... pieces of what looks like written in undercommon, which you can't read, so you assume it might be the paperwork. You see kind of burnt pieces of parchment that would or could be. You might pass it to Elon to verify.
Can I read this? I can.
You
read
can
it.
Read it.
If so
you,
I can speak and read.
I'm okay. Assuming if you know the language of undercommon.
Sweeney, why do
you
have to blow
well?
Up everything that we want to take with us?
Because I've died twice, and if we let people live, I'm worried it'll happen a third
time.
Yeah,
but why do you got to blow them up?
I don't know. I didn't think he would have the papers we needed.
I can teach you how to swing a sword.
Hey, I have a forgery kit. Let's just...
Oh, you do?
Let's just doctor some papers using this as reference.
We got a wizard here.
Okay, so I'm going to have this
That's
be
a
team check, because remember, since Sweeney can't read it, Elon's going to have to translate for you and how it is shown in the paperwork.
Just
you guys, here's the thing. You're going to have to fill in some blanks.
Yes.
Because some of the words are missing.
Is this deception?
This would be a deception check, and I wouldn't say it's sleight of hand, so yeah, I'd probably just say this is a deception check. You guys can make a test together.
I like at the
this.
Checkpoint, they're like papers, and you hand them a taped together, bloody, weird, drawn-on thing.
Or no, I'm just going to make new ones. It'll just be very fresh ink.
Okay.
I got lost.
This ink is still wet.
Okay, so my +8 gives me a 12.
Okay.
Good.
Help.
Elon?
I think that
now
looks great.
Now I roll for deception, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
So I've got a -1. Gives me...
They're so smart.
Oh, with a 20 is 19.
So you rolled a natural 20. Okay. Okay. I'll keep that in mind. But it is a 19, but you did roll a
natural
20 on that.
That's as good as it gets.
Okay, I'll take it.
Nice. Maybe you've seen some of these passes in the past as you've traveled through the Underdark.
So my version of it is crappy,
But the writing but is the, all there.
But it's correct.
The content is accurate.
Yeah.
It's just my translation of it that maybe...
Exactly.
Yeah. All right.
So you guys return to the caravan, board, pass the paperwork up to Elon. You whip the horses and start riding into town.
I'm just blowing on them.
Are we still supposed to pretend we're slaves?
Yes.
We have to look crappy because it's going to actually help our disguise getting into the town.
Just another day.
And then we can look as beautiful as we want.
Okay.
We could do some prestidigitation. Okay. You'll be back to your pink
Every
self.
Moment you're not beautiful is a moment of my life wasted.
In fact, I can change the appearance of this spell anytime I want to.
Oh.
I can make you even more beautiful than you were before.
Not possible. No. Okay. I appreciate the sentiment.
Challenge accepted.
Oh, I think we've got a contest.
A beauty contest?
Yeah.
Beauty contest episode?
Makeover.
We haven't had one of those in a long time.
So the caravan rides up. You see a Dorgar step out with a hammer at its side, and it walks up to the caravan and eyes you, Elon, and starts speaking Dwarven.
Oh.
Uh-oh.
Oh, I speak Dwarven.
And says something in Dwarven you don't recognize. Izzy, you overhear it, and it says, "Welcome, brother. Pass me your papers."
Give him the papers. I say to Elon, "Give him the papers."
And then I look at you and I go, "Okay, I can see that you have understood what he said." And I'm gonna Izzy's right there by my side as a little bit of a translator.
Isn't she in the?
She's behind him in the caravan.
And I'm like whispering up. Behind you, like, "Give him
just
the papers."
Behind me.
Like,
Yeah. So does he know that I cannot understand Dwarvish?
It's based on your response. Do you say anything?
So I keep my cool. Izzy says, "Give him the papers." Keep my cool. Grab the papers. Hand them to him.
So you don't say anything. You just kind of coldly hand him the papers.
Because I don't want to say anything. Because I don't. I mean, should I speak in undercommon?
No.
You can do whatever you want.
Disregard are not very friendly. So
he eyes you. He takes the papers. He looks through them. Feels them. Bends the papers in his hands to feel the texture. Smells them and looks up at you.
What a fucker.
I was just thinking that. I mean, fondle in the papers.
Why don't you just marry them?
Takes his job very seriously.
Buy a drink first.
And as you guys are here, actually, and as you see him really kind of taking his time looking at these, I'd like all of you to roll perception of the area around. Horace.
Eight.
15.
Izzy? Sweeney?
23.
Yeah, so I get an 11.
Okay.
Smelling that.
So Elon, you notice a little bit as he's eyeing the paperwork. You do notice, like, huh, he's really taking a pretty strong look at these. Izzy, you definitely notice, and Sweeney, you certainly do. You look around as this is happening, and you see by this kind of checkpoint into the town, you can see where he's standing, where he's come out of, is this kind of beautifully built dark stone slab, and it looks like it has just recently been carved. And you see kind of a newer hut on the other side that has two drow warriors standing by eyeing your caravan. It looks like some of these newer people that are here at the front and at the checkpoints, all of the structures and setup does seem to be new, like it has been recently added. The Dorgar checks it, smells it again, looks up at you, says another thing in Dwarven, "Was everything all right back there?"
Nod.
I'm nodding.
And then speaks in Dwarven again. "Something's got your tongue?"
Cough really bad. like you're sick.
the Dorgar.
And then I say louder, "Sick!" in Dwarven.
Well, he wouldn't know.
To mimic his voice?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, as he's coughing?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm definitely going to need you to make a deception roll for that.
Can I cast a spell?
Oh, deceptive rolled so well. 20.
Whoa, okay. What were you gonna cast?
I was gonna cast command. You speak a one word command to a creature you can see within range. Target must succeed on a wisdom saving throw or follow the command on its next turn.
Are you gonna Jedi mind trick this guy?
That's what I'm going to.
Well,
I'll do both.
So I'll see if I'm gonna insight. He's gonna insight check on what just happened there.
See if it believes me, and if he doesn't believe.
Okay, and now what's the command check?
Oh no, hang on a minute, I'm in trouble.
What's the word?
Spell has no effect if the target is undead. Target's fine, right? If it doesn't understand your language, or if you command it directly.
So maybe just leave it. Just leave it to the deception.
So I did a 20 on my deception.
So, and you said, what did you say in Dwarven?
Sick.
In like as deep as a voice as you could?
Sick in Dwarven is...
the Dwargar looks up at you, Elon. eyes narrow, and laughs, and says again in Dwarven, "This'll steady your stomach," and pulls out a flagon of ale and passes it to you, pats you on the shoulder, and then waves his hand for you to move along.
I don't have to kill this guy now.
Wow, Duragars are very friendly to each other.
That's nice. That's probably poison, because the weak in Duragar, they like to kill immediately, so we throw that out immediately.
Yeah, TGIF for Duragar is basically death.
Even if it's not like him trying to poison a weaker person, it's Duragar ale. Yeah. That's straight up poison.
Yeah. It's like ethanol.
So you whip the horses and you ride into the town.
We did it! Woo!
Yes.
Thanks for listening to this week's episode. The Velvet League will return next Friday with part two of our adventure with Taylor Glockner. You can follow Taylor on Instagram at Taylor_Glockner. You can follow the rest of the Velvet League on Twitter. Jeremy is at JLeeFox. Kelly is at GirlMeetsBear. And Mike is at SuperGeekMike. If you like the show, please consider leaving a rating and review on iTunes. Every 5-star review really helps new people find the show. So thank you. Photos and character art can be found in the show notes on partialarc.com. And while you're there, why not check out some of our other podcasts, including Because Comics, where Mike Christensen and I talk about the weird and wacky stories of comic books. If you have any questions about the show, you can email us at fridaynightquests@gmail.com. You can also follow us on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and Tumblr, all under the handle Partial Arc. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you on the battlefield.
Yeah, I'm gonna loot the body.
So, how much experience do we get?
Well, now we have a skeleton army, so that's pretty neat.